from the nation's capital. WJLA TV Channel 7 brings you comprehensive coverage of the day's events. News 7 at 5.
Good evening. It's the fourth leading cause of death in the United States, and you've probably never heard of it.
Well, it's a disease you get in the most unlikely of places, and it contributes to 80,000 deaths a year, more than auto accidents. Consumer editor Roberta Baskin has been investigating, and tonight she begins with part one of her special report on the secret disease.
Paul, the clinical name for the disease is nosocomial infection. It means the disease of being taken care of. And this year alone, at least 2 million patients will be afflicted. Where do you get it? The hospital. It's a secret because many times it's classified by doctors and nurses under the heading of complications. But in many cases, there's nothing complicated about it, because at least a third of nosocomial infections could be prevented.
Don't worry, you'll be okay. We're going to put an oxygen mask on you now. You should start breathing easier. Yeah, that'll be fine.
For the millions of people who check into hospitals every year, there is an expectation that no matter what ails them, they'll receive proper treatment, hopefully get better, and go home. But many times the sick get sicker, and not for the reasons they checked in. Hospitals are generally regarded as safe, sterile facilities, antiseptic environments, but they are jungles of bacteria. Remember, the beds are filled with sick people, and without strict infection control, hospitals can become breeding grounds for life-threatening diseases. Dr. Peter Heseltine is in charge of infection control at a major medical center in Los Angeles.
Two out of every three infections that we treat in the hospital are in fact hospital-acquired infections. So that gives you some magnitude of the problem.
And which hospital-acquired infections are most common? A 10-year study by the federal government found that urinary tract infections account for most cases, followed by infections of surgical wounds, pneumonia, and infections of the bloodstream.
If I could make this waterproof and hang it outside.
Lisa Hinds was a victim of a hospital-acquired infection. An artist and dancer, Lisa entered the hospital for what was supposed to be simple foot surgery.
I never thought I was going to be in there that long. Every day I said, when will I be getting out? And they said, well, 3 days. And, you know, three more days, I'd say, well, am I getting out soon? He'd say, well, three more days.
Lisa developed a serious staph infection and was moved to isolation.
And they didn't tell me why I got put in isolation either. I just had to assume everything for myself, and I assumed that it was because they were afraid that my infection would spread to other people who had minor surgery.
There's a whole lot of stuff here.
Along with the pain she suffered, Lisa also had to pay the price for a longer stay in the hospital. That's the financial consequence of hospital-acquired diseases. Nosocomial infections add up to 8 million extra days in the hospital every year at a cost of $4 billion.
Well, you're wired up to a lot of spaghetti, and in the course of the next couple of days, all that equipment will come out.
Adding to the problem of hospital-acquired infections is today's greater use of high-tech medicine.
So we have to balance the risk of using this equipment with the risk of infection.
If we put a needle into somebody's arm, into their vein, that is a potential avenue where bacteria, viruses, fungi can get into the bloodstream. If we put tubes into parts of people's bodies like their bladder or down into their stomach, potentially bacteria or fungi can in fact follow that route of entry.
The watchdog federal agency on hospital infections is the CDC in Atlanta. They don't have any enforcement power, but they do have medical detectives who investigate infection outbreaks and try to determine what went wrong. Dr. Tom Safranek, an epidemiologist, investigated an incident where a group of patients undergoing plastic surgery developed infections. The surgeon had used a skin marking solution to trace the line of incision. The marker was later found to be contaminated. Once the incisions were made, the solution entered the cuts, causing the wounds to become infected.
It was disfiguring. Patients who went in for improved facial features for their facelift operations were actually ending up with deforming scars in the areas of the operation, scars resulting from these unresolved infections.
A CDC study shows that those hospitals that do make the extra effort to control hospital-acquired infections are having success. Most hospitals now have at least one person in charge of nothing but infection control.
And we look to see suction tubing and equipment looks clean. It looks like it's been cleaned between patients and so on.
Tomorrow we'll make the rounds with the person in charge at a major teaching hospital as we check out possible trouble spots and problem areas that could be breeding the secret disease. And the most common trouble spot should be as familiar as the back of your hand. As a matter of fact, it is your hand. You'll see an amazing demonstration of how simple hand washing could have eliminated thousands of cases of nosocomial infections. We'll show you that tomorrow.
I guess the question that I would have as a patient is, what can I do as a patient to make sure that I don't fall victim to this, Roberta?
Well, one of the things, Paul, that we'll get into tomorrow, shouldn't touch you, is hands and hand washing and making sure that nurses and doctors do wash their hands. You'd be surprised how often they don't. But there are, you know, it's being a good patient advocate for yourself, asking, is this operation really necessary? If you have a catheter in you, which is, as one doctor described it, a highway for bacteria, saying, when can this catheter come out, or do I need a catheter at all? The longer you stay in the hospital, the more vulnerable you are to getting a nosocomial infection, so you want to get in and out as fast as possible.
They do keep records on this. Is one department in the hospital that's better than another, or a place that's more problematic?
They keep very good records on nosocomial infections, but they're records that patients really don't have access to. Every hospital has a nosocomial infection committee in order to be accredited, and there are certain areas of the hospital that are at greater risk. If you go in to have a baby, that's not as big a risk as if you're going into intensive care. The more vulnerable you are, the more vulnerable you are to bacteria and to the tougher bugs that hospitals have.
Okay, we look forward to part two tomorrow. Thank you very much.
Cholesterol.
Well, the fourth leading cause of death in this country is the secret disease. Its real name? Nosocomial infection. It's the disease you can get only by checking into the hospital. Consumer editor Roberta Baskin has been investigating the causes of this secret disease that contributes to 80,000 deaths every year. Roberta?
Paul, there are any number of causes of hospital-acquired infections, but in all cases, it means you checked into the hospital in hopes of getting better and picked up an infection that made you worse. In many cases, those infections have resulted in death. Medical experts agree that about a third of these infections could be eliminated by using proper infection control techniques. But too often, the hospital's stated policies don't match the day-to-day actions of its staff.
Mm-hmm. And our supplies are closely kept to mm-hmm. the patient.
Do you keep the cart cover down?
We try to as much as possible. But
Dr. Diane Fleming is making her daily rounds, only she's not checking up on patients. She's checking up on fellow doctors, nurses, and hospital workers.
Yeah, we're looking for needles and syringes and tubes, make sure that they're properly sterilized and properly packaged, and the linens are in good shape and covered.
As this hospital's biosafety officer, Dr. Fleming is scouting for problem areas that might put patients at risk of infection. With a reported 2 million cases of hospital-acquired infections every year, she knows you can't be too careful.
We want to check the hand-washing situation, make sure that they have all the equipment that they need, as again, make sure that the dispenser is full of towels. They have no excuse not to wash their hands as long as we've provided them with the materials. We do go to areas where they don't have a single towel left and say, well,
it can't help. Do they think of you as a cop?
Some of them do, yeah. Why are you here? What have I done wrong? And so you haven't done anything wrong. We're just here to make sure that everything's going right.
Your mother isn't alone in always reminding you to wash your hands. It's number one in infection control from the smallest hospital all the way up to the National Institutes of Health.
Hospital-acquired infections are most easily prevented using straightforward hand washing. Hand washing is the most important way of preventing hospital-acquired infections.
And if you're not convinced, ask Dr. Elaine Larson, affectionately known as the guru of hand washing. If there is an expert on the subject, she's it.
Bacteria in general do not fly through the air. They may live a very short time in the air, they may live a very short time in the environment, but most of the time, the kinds of bacteria that cause infections are transferred from patient to patient on the hands of healthcare personnel.
Dr. Larson showed me firsthand just how effective hand washing can be. In a simple experiment, we cultured my hand in a petri dish before and after I washed my hands. Then we let the bacteria incubate for a few days, and the results were dramatic.
They have grown by the thousands so that they're now visible to the eye. So you can see that the hand washing reduced the numbers of bacteria on your skin by about 20 times.
I decided to test how easily germs could be spread, with a group of nursing students at Johns Hopkins. First, I coated my hand with a spray that glows under ultraviolet light, then went about introducing myself with a good, strong handshake.
Hello. Nice to meet you. Hi.
Hi.
I'm Roberta Baskin. Nice, firm handshake there. I like that.
As we sat in on the class, our camera proceeded to follow where their hands went next, and where didn't they go?
What's a nurse's responsibility in an informed consent? Nurse's responsibility is, if the patients have any questions regarding the information that the physician told them, you can do several things.
Just before class ended, I let them in on my little experiment.
This is called clue spray, and it gives us a trail from the time that we met and shook hands, some of us, to where your hands have been during this class. We just need to dim the light.
The ultraviolet light revealed just how far a handshake can travel.
Oh, wow.
Mondo.
Yeah, it's on the paper.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's all over.
It's probably all over our desk, too.
What does it make you think about in terms of patient contacts?
Well, it makes you really aware of what you're bringing to your patients and from other patients.
You are a major fidgeter, huh?
Yeah, I have a problem.
It makes you nervous a little bit. Makes you feel like, if it's so subconscious, you put it on your face, then you do that all the time when you're with a patient, and it could really be detrimental to the other patients.
Yeah. I'll definitely wash my hands a lot more.
When doctors and nurses move from patient to patient, they are breaking the most basic rule in infection control if they fail to wash their hands in between touching.
If I were a patient and a doctor or a nurse were coming to touch me, I would be sure that they washed their hands, and if I didn't see them wash their hands, I would ask them if they had washed their hands.
Many people will feel intimidated about asking their doctor or nurse if they've washed their hands, but hand washing can mean the difference between life and death. What's more, studies show that doctors wash their hands less frequently than nurses. In fact, one major study showed that doctors were washing up only 14% of the time in between patient contacts. So protect yourself and ask. Don't be intimidated.
Well, you ask your doctor whether he's washed your hands, you can increase your bill by about $4,000.
I'd rather do that. You'll increase it by $4,000 if you don't ask him.
Are things getting better now in the hospitals? Are they really?
They're getting a little bit better. For one thing, AIDS has had an impact on that because it's making them feel about the protecting themselves. So they're wearing a lot more gloves and washing their hands more often to protect themselves. That protects the patient, too.
And I dare say doctors probably would be glad to have a patient remind them.
I think the good ones will not mind.
Okay, thank you. Very interesting educational series. We appreciate that.
Well, this week, consumer editor Roberta Baskin has been reporting on the spread of the secret disease, hospital-acquired infections that claim 80,000 lives each year. Hospitals can reduce the risk to patients through very careful infection control, but they cannot eliminate the problem altogether. Roberta is here tonight with that part of the story. Roberta?
Susan, a procedure as simple as doctors and nurses washing their hands can prevent much of the infection risk to hospital patients. So can proper sterilization of equipment and tracing outbreaks of infection. But health experts have run up against one cause of infection that manages to stay one step ahead of their efforts.
The discoverer of penicillin, the British bacteriologist Sir Alexander Fleming, said that it happened in 1928 through pure luck.
The invention of penicillin was a miracle breakthrough in the war against germs. Drug companies saw dollar signs and began producing more antibiotics. But scientists soon discovered how clever germs can be. Almost as fast as scientists developed new antibiotics, bacteria learned how to fight back and become resistant. Today's hospitals are filled with all kinds of super germs and all kinds of super drugs to combat them. It is a vicious cycle. In some cases, a strain of bacteria will sweep through a hospital before anything can be developed to stop it.
There's little doubt that hospitals do have tougher bugs. The organisms in hospitals are much more resistant to antibiotics, much more difficult to treat with antibiotics than the infections or the organisms that one encounters on the outside.
Part of the reason germs become more resistant is due to the overuse and abuse of antibiotics. As a result, the cost of germ warfare is constantly on the increase, and stronger antibiotics take their toll on patients as well.
We can't use the normal or expected antibiotic. We have to go to a different one that can be a little more toxic, certainly more expensive, and it might keep the patient on prolonged antibiotic therapy.
Nancy Sampson was put on antibiotics after undergoing surgery, but she developed a serious infection anyway that sent her back into surgery for a second time.
Apparently, the surgery that I had carried a very high infection rate, and I was not informed of that by my doctor. I was in the hospital for 8 days. I was on antibiotics I'd never heard of before, around the clock, and I was sent home with antibiotics.
Studies show that half the days and half the cost spent recovering from hospital-acquired infections are the result of surgery. Usually, it's the operating technique that is the cause of surgical infections.
When you go into an operating room, it looks like everyone's doing the perfect thing. But when you get familiar with an operation, you see little mistakes. And I think it's those little break-in techniques that cause that.
By monitoring surgical techniques, hospitals can trace the source of infection.
By studying post-operative cesarean delivery problems, we've been able to cut the infection rate from 30% to 5 or 10%, which is the national average, simply by instituting some simple interventions at the time of delivery.
Some hospitals have a policy of reporting post-operative infections directly back to the surgeon. Dr. Tom Safranek, an epidemiologist, studied the problem at the Centers for Disease Control.
Distressingly, few hospitals have adopted the policy of strictly reporting surgical wound infection rates back to the surgeons who are doing the operations.
Because doctors don't want to admit to having a problem?
I think there may be an element of professional pride, maybe some defensiveness about retribution from the hospital were an excessive number of infections reported for a given surgeon. I think a surgeon might be concerned about that.
A surgeon is also supposed to be concerned about operating in as sterile an environment as possible. Strict infection control forbids the wearing of jewelry, and hair is supposed to be completely covered. You can't see the bacteria, but you can see that the rules to prevent its spread aren't always followed.
We have to be very vigilant in all of our behaviors so that we don't give them something they didn't come in with, like a nosocomial infection.
You may not remember the name nosocomial, but I hope you remember what it means. It's the disease of being taken care of, and it's important to remember that if you or a loved one is hospitalized, you shouldn't take for granted that you are being taken care of properly.
Well, I know I've heard from people, I think Paul has too, who are going to the hospital such, and they're asking me, is there a way they can find out how a hospital rates, what their conditions are? Can they check for themselves before they go in? Can you tell us some tips?
It's a good question. Different hospitals have different rates of nosocomial infections, in fact. But if a hospital has a high rate, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's bad. It could mean that that hospital is very diligent about checking up on doctors and on their procedures. And so they have a higher rate because they're more careful. They're really looking for it. Mm. Most hospitals, all of the experts say, underestimate their rate of these infections. So it's just something to be aware of, to ask a lot of questions when you're a patient.
Is there a consumer guide where you can find the good hospitals versus the not so good?
There is no guide about nose. In fact, recently there was a guide put out about picking a hospital, but they did not get into nosocomial infections. It's a very difficult area.
Sometimes your doctor can be very helpful too in terms of talking. I mean, if you talk to your doctor about the hospital,
what your concerns are, and particularly what you're going in for, and what the risks of infections are with a particular procedure.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Thank you much. Interesting series, and we enjoyed it. I think you told our audience a lot that they needed to know.